Good evening, and welcome to our Resilience Hope Lives Here three-part professional development series. We are so glad you can join us for our final part. My name is Nicole Sanchez, and I had the honor and privilege of working on a really important documentary, originally called Resilient Idaho, Hope Lives Here. That documentary is now available to all PBS stations. It's under a new title, Resilience, Hope Lives Here. In this story, we look at adverse childhood experiences, or ACEs for short. We also worked very hard to focus on resilience, something that was important to us. We wanted to make sure we showed real life examples of people being able to move forward after trauma. If you were with us in our first session, you know we viewed the documentary there. If you missed it, at the end of our program, we will share a link so you can check it out. Also, just a few housekeeping items. Reminder, we are recording tonight's session. It will also be posted online, so if you want to rewatch anything or share it with a friend. And we are so excited that by attending the event series, you are eligible for professional development credit. Carrie Wardle is the education manager at Idaho Public Television, and she's here to share a little bit more about the credit options. Carrie.
Hi, guys. Thank you all for attending tonight. I think most of you maybe know by now, but if you're joining us for the first time, this is available for professional development credit for educators through Idaho State University. There are a couple of important things. I have some children in the background, so if you'll all excuse me. There's a couple of important things you need to know. Even if you have already joined the Google Classroom, you need to register through ISU by October 31st. That is the cutoff for the registration. You're going to have until November 30th to actually submit all the work and do all of that stuff, but the registration needs to be done by October 31st. I'll drop my name in the chat here in a second, or my email, and if you have any questions about it, you're welcome to email me. And then, like I said, available through ISU One Professional Development Credit, and we're excited that we can offer that for you. So feel free to reach out if you have any questions about that.
Great. Thank you so much, Carrie. Roger Sherman, he's going to talk to us about some of the other credits. He's the executive director of Idaho Children's Plus Fund. Hi, Roger.
Hi, Nicole. Yes, for anybody who is a social worker or a counselor,
David.
Not connected to the schools. I love it. I love that the kids came up in the middle of the picture. It was beautiful. Anybody who's looking for CEUs if you're a social worker or a counselor, maybe not connected to the schools, don't need professional development credit. These contact hours count, as do your participation in the recorded classes. Those CEUs are coming via Boise State University School of Social Work. I will also pop my email into the chat, and if you need those credits, please just reach out to me. Thanks, Nicole. Awesome.
Thank you, Roger. And no worries, Carrie. I know my kids are out of the house, but I have a dog, so we'll see what happens. I took her out right before this started, so it's live, it's fun, we understand. Okay, we've got a really exciting workshop tonight. We have two special guests, Florina Ruvio. She is Idaho Public Television's family education specialist. She supports parents and caregivers throughout the state in nurturing a love of learning in their children. Florina is also a Hope Conquers ACEs trainer through the Idaho Children's Trust Fund. Florina, hi.
Hi, thanks for coming. I appreciate you guys all showing up today. I'm excited to get started.
Nice. Presenting with Florina will be Shanie Mantz, who is a special education teacher up in the Coeur d'Alene School District. She's committed to collaborative learning that engages students, staff, families, and the community. For 12 years, she has taught all ages and all abilities at various schools in both the Treasure Valley and Northern Idaho. Shanie, it's nice to have you with us.
Thank you.
Okay, everybody, after our presentation, we will have some time for a little Q&A. And for now, Florina and Shanie, take it away.
All right, thank you. Okay, so Shanie here is gonna share a screen so we can start. So again, my name's Florina and this is Shanie, and we're gonna be talking about resilience in the classroom. So what we'll discuss today is what trauma looks like, building for felt safety in the classroom, some tools and strategies you can use with the kids, that, and some of them they can actually take home with them, and some things to remember when working with children with trauma. So we'll just do a quick review of some of the stuff that we talked about in the last two presentations, the last two webinars, particularly adverse childhood experiences. These are factors that are said to have lifelong effects on children that can be kind of grouped into three categories: abuse, neglect, or household dysfunction, and then trauma. This is one of the simplest explanations or definitions of that is an event or experience that overwhelms someone's ability to cope. So I think that Nadine Burke-Harris put it best. She gave an example that it's like walking in the woods, right? You're out on a beautiful hike, the weather's clear and everything looks great and it's sunny and green and everything smells like nice and everything's calm. And then all of a sudden you round the corner and there's a bear, you know, and just think about how you would feel if you went from, you know, calm, nice walk in the woods to this giant bear that you're faced with, right? Your heart is racing, you're sweaty, you're, you know, you feel your throat clamp up, all of these physical things happen, and then your fight, flight, or freeze instincts take over, right? And so just thinking about that aspect, that situation, that is what it's like for children. If you imagine living with the bear, that's what that feels like when kids are not regulated. And so now Shanie's gonna talk about what it looks like in the classroom.
Sorry, jumped right on you there.
No, you're all right.
The next thing is, what does trauma look like? Because obviously the kid's not like, I live with a scary bear. So what does that look like for them? What does it sound like or feel like? So we've listed out some of the things that it could possibly look like. So it could look like, you know, you gently touch a kid on their shoulder and they jump or startle easily. They may seem disinterested or shut down. They could be really excitable or have extreme emotions. They might have a regression like academically or with some other like motor skills. They might struggle to trust other people, especially adults. They might have difficulty following directions, difficulty remembering things, needing to control, or some of those aggressive behaviors. It might look like anxiety, or it could be a kid that just constantly needs your reassurance.
So now that you've been through the first two webinars and you know what ACEs is, what that looks like in the body, and some of the things going on, right? And some of the lifelong effects that they have. Now you have all this information. So now what, right? Like, now we're going to talk about how we build those trauma-informed classrooms and what can be done in real life situations to kind of help children who are suffering from trauma. So part of safety begins with hello. So there's a study that shows that there's a 20% increase in academic engagement just from greeting students at the door. So there's also a decrease in classroom disruption by 9%. While it's not very big, it really is just a small thing that you can do at the, like, right from the beginning to build that safety and that connection for those kids, right? Just saying hello. On the next page here, we have a video kind of explaining more about the importance of saying hello.
Child's cognitive skills. The driver for learning is the social connection. Activating a child's cognitive skills begins with activating their social connectedness. Children in this school are starting the day with an adult saying to them, I see you, I know you, I'm connecting with you, and you're important to me.
We start each day by greeting every kid at the door.
Good morning, Declan.
You look pretty, Miss Turner.
Thank you, baby.
Every classroom does some variation of, would you like a high five, handshake, or hug? Essentially, it's what greeting would you like?
How you doing, handsome?
Good.
There is a great deal of cultural sensitivity and empowerment for children to say, here is how I want to greet you.
High five, handshake, or hug. You got your hair done? Good morning, Molly. You got your hair done? Let me just turn around. I love it. All right, we're gonna have a good day today? All right. High five, handshake, or hug.
During that time, I'm just trying to connect with them.
All right.
Help them from their transition from home to school. And just kind of like a pulse check to see where they are.
Oh, I knew you wanted a hug. Arr. How are you feeling today, sir?
Good.
We're gonna have a good day? Look at my eyes.
Do they look escalated? Do they look triggered? Do they look upset? So it's a way for me to see, okay, who needs to be where? How can I help? How can I be assistance to start their day off most effectively?
Good morning, Ariella. How you doing today?
I'm being very intentional about my interactions with students, right? So it's not just I'm in the back of the room. Hey, come in. No, I'm making a connection with them. I have eye contact with them. I'm checking in how they're doing. I'm checking to make sure they're okay.
Good morning, friends.
Good morning, friends.
I think the impact is deep relationships. I get to know my students. I get to check in with them. I get to find out something about them. They get to find out something about me. We get to make a connection. And that starts with the greeting at the door.
All right, come on in.
So a child is walking in the door feeling cared for, empowered, and encouraged. And that teacher is focusing in on who that child is. And that's how the day starts.
So here's just a little sample of some of the things you can say or do to greet children at the door. You can give them the option, right? And so this is just a little sheet we put together with some different options that you can use. They can wave hello, they can smile, they can wink, you can high five, say hello, do a 5-second happy dance, heart hands. So whatever works best for, you know, whatever you're comfortable with and the kids are comfortable with, you can certainly give them those choices in the morning. And it takes like 5 seconds as they're coming in the door.
I love those. Another way that we can help kids feel safe is by giving them a schedule that's predictable and expected. And I work with students with cognitive differences, so they utilize picture schedules. So on the left, you can see an individualized picture schedule. So that's for one of my students. And his name is covered, but he uses that and checks them off as they go. Staff that work directly with him or myself change those out day to day. So if we're going to have a fire drill, we add that on there so that it's expected, it's predictable. He knows what's coming. And then on the right there, you can see the visual schedule that we use for our whole class. So that's a real day in my real classroom from just a few weeks ago. At first, it was a little bit of work to get that up and running, but with some cardstock, a laminator, and a printer, and then just those little magnets that you have on your fridge from Papa Murphy's or whatever from the pizza company, we cut those up and taped them on the back, so it was really cheap or nearly free, and got those stuck up there so the kids know when they come in, or the students rather, know when they come in the morning what's expected, what's gonna happen that day, what time things are happening, just so that the schedule is predictable and they know what's up ahead of them.
Just one more note about the schedules and stuff. It just builds a sense of safety and security, and it really helps children who have a hard time with transitions because it gives them that sense, you know, that they know what's happening. And on that slide, there's a link as well for some picture schedules for those younger kids that is on our learning media, which we can share later as well. So one of the things that some children have trouble with is transition. So children with trauma can have trouble going from one activity to the next. So a way to help with that can be timers. So if you see this timer up here on the right-hand corner, it shows that red bit, and when that red, you know, and then it's gonna move as that time goes on. Or the sand timers, those are also really effective because they can see when the time they can see the time going down. And so then they know like, hey, this is almost done. I have so much time before the next activity. Another item there on the side is a digital counter that you, like a digital timer that you can put on your whiteboard. And then Shanie here added a digital one that you can just look up in Google and it'll count down and gives them like a fun graphic to look at as that time goes down. So it's just really about referring to the schedule, making sure that you're sticking to that schedule, and then, you know, showing them how that time progresses. It's really helpful with those transitions because then it's not unexpected for them. And these are all from, I just grabbed these pictures from Lakeshore Learning, by the way.
So next we're gonna talk about just some tools and strategies to use with students. The first one, I think, Florina, you're gonna share about some things you've seen firsthand.
Yeah, so at one of the elementary schools that I've helped at, they have a sensory hallway, and it really is a great idea to have. And it's really kind of simple. These can range in price anywhere from like $20 to thousands of dollars. But honestly, you could probably, if you have like a crafty mom who likes to make, you know, stuff with her circuit, they can make a little like handprints and footprints, and you kind of make it your own. You can do like hopscotch or the alphabet, or here's a picture of the crazy eight. It's just a place to give the kids a break to get some of that energy out, right? And so they can regulate and get ready to learn again. At that school, it's just out in the hallway, and if they need to go out there for a minute, they're allowed that time to go out there and then come back to learn. Another thing they do is they take time out of the day they have a track outside of the school, and they just take time out of their day to do walks. So every class in that elementary school takes a few minutes to walk the track around the school, giving those kids a much needed break.
And I love that point that you're saying, like, this can be something purchased that's, you know, some of the ones that we found in researching were, you know, $1,000, and some of these are, you know, really simple. And, you know, the one on the far left was even an Amazon that was cheap. And if you got two, you could really put a good hallway together. And they might be seen as things that only little kids would like, but I think it's important to remember, you know, even our high school students are just, you know, big kids and little body, or, you know, I'm sorry, little kids and big bodies, and they still need that movement too. So this next slide shows some other ways that we can give kids calm down, maybe when they're even more dysregulated. So flexible seating in the classroom, you know, comfortable seats, such as like, you know, an old recliner from a neighbor or something like that, that's not necessarily expensive, but gives kids a way to still participate in learning with, you know, a comfortable place to sit. And then there's a picture kind of in the lower right there. It's actually my classroom where kids have, you know, maybe they have an office chair that's kind of teacher size, someone sitting on an exercise ball there. And then you can see in the corner, there's an exercise bike. Additionally, there's places to like nap if they need to take a nap. It's worth it to spend 30 minutes of a little like cat nap to have the rest of the day of some great learning. So lots of different options and ways to just give kids, you know, choice and the ability to re-regulate.
I think those are great because you don't have to dedicate, you don't have to have a lot of space. It doesn't have to be an entire corner, but even just giving just some place for a child to go to kind of gather, you know, collect themselves again. I worked with a child once who did not sit still. He couldn't help himself, you know? And so we just got this, one of these piece of carpets in a round shape. And like, this is like, here's your space. And this is where you can, you know, do what you need to do. And so he would dance and jiggle and stuff, but he stayed in his space, and it really kind of helped him regulate and stay on task, which was really helpful. And so this is just kind of talking about zones of regulation again. I know that Keith mentioned this in the last webinar. Here it's broken down a little simpler for those elementary kids, so that this is a good time in the morning as well to check in with them, you know, after their greeting, like where they're at on the zone of regulation, or if you see that they are kind of getting frustrated or they seem a little sad, you can have them refer to the zones of regulation. and talk about where they are at that scale.
So we're going to put you guys into some breakout rooms. So I just want to tell you what to expect in advance of that. We're practicing what we preach here. So we'll give you kind of the rules and what's going to happen, and then put you in some breakout rooms. So what you'll do in your room is introduce yourself to your breakout room partners. Just, you know, quick, like, my name's Shanie and I'm from Coeur d'Alene is adequate. You're going to choose one of the participants in your room to be a scribe. So that means that they're going to type what everybody else says. And then you're going to spend 5 minutes listing off as many emotions as you can. Your full breakout session, I think, is 5 minutes. So it might be more like 4 minutes after you do introductions. You will be put into breakout rooms automatically. You have to click join, and then it will prompt you to come back to the bigger room when your breakout session is over. Okay, people kind of starting to pop back in, it looks like. There might be a few more kind of stragglers. Welcome back. Hope you were able to make an awesome list. So if you were the scribe, go ahead and put in the chat how many, or if you didn't count, about how many your group came up with. So how many emotions was your group able to come up? Oh, 25, wow. Great job. Lee, I saw your front post falls. Hi. 32. Great job, Kathleen. Okay, a couple more scribes. Another 32. Hi, Amy.
You guys are great at this.
Yeah. Good job, Carlos. I saw you pop up too. Cool. Okay, awesome. Well, you guys are doing great. You have more skills than, you know, a traditional American, because the list of emotions is usually somewhere around like 6 or 8. Usually we Americans don't have a huge vocabulary with emotions, and that even goes for adults. You know, we have mad, sad, angry, happy. So I'm really proud of you guys for doing that. Florina, I'm going to flip over to that next, the naming emotions side.
Yeah. And so the reason we did this exercise is because it's important for children to know how to name and express their emotions in a healthy manner. Having the ability to name your emotions and to be able to deal with them in an appropriate manner is really one of the 5 protective factors that's said to mitigate child abuse. And so it really is a skill that will benefit children throughout their life, not just in learning, but in all aspects, in their relationships, just in work, wherever you go. And so the more emotions that you can name, the better off you are able to communicate how you're feeling. And so this right here is just a little poster that our PBS Kids has that's available for free on the PBS Kids for Parents website. Just a little poster you can print out if you'd like that says happy, sad, excited, has a few of those emotions to name. I also have this one on the next slide that I really liked. It kind of refers back to that zones of regulation. It's called the feelings thermometer from Wisconsin's Children's Mental Health. But I liked that it has not just the feelings, but what you can do about it on the side. And that web address is just right there on the side as well underneath. So I really like this thermometer because it really ties in well to those zones of regulation. It's just another great example of that.
Yeah, that one definitely is great for older kids too. I think the first one you showed, you know, kids that are, you know, cognitively impaired or, you know, lower functioning or younger. And then this one is phenomenal for our older friends. So thank you. Those are great. So the next thing we want to talk about, because even though we can label our emotions now because we have these awesome graphics and we're teaching kids how to label their emotions and we're, you know, telling them how we're feeling and we're just using lots of emotion words, we still sometimes get dysregulated. So we need to add in some coping skills or coping strategies. Another way that we talk to younger kids about this might be called calm down strategy. But we have options like finger breathing. This one they do at my children's elementary school. So my kids are school age and I work in a district that's working really hard to be trauma informed. And finger breathing is as simple as up and down our finger as we breathe. Everybody has, you know, the ability to do that without any you know, high tech thing. You're just have use your hand to do that. And then the hot chocolate breathing is pretending like you have that mug in front of you and blowing it to cool off. So just, you know, for our younger kids or, you know, our delayed learners, teaching them how to use breathing as a way to calm down. And then we also sometimes talk about being a superhero to kids. So they have different powers they can use. So when you're frustrated, you have powers that you can use. You have the power of walking away, the power of ignoring, and then the power of using your words. So those are phenomenal for kids. And then Florina, you want to talk to us about brain breaks?
So brain breaks are important throughout the day, just to give kids and yourself a break throughout the day, right? When you're in the middle of maybe a lesson that's a little tougher for kids to get, or just if they've been sitting for a really long time, they're great at like the beginning of the day, after lunch, you know, after recess, and like right before the day ends, just whenever you feel like the kids need a break. And they don't have to be long. It, you know, they could be in their desks and you can just say, okay, brain break, you know, 5 second dance, and everybody gets out of their chair and dances, or, you know, the sound of your favorite animal. And so it just gives them a chance to kind of think of something else and to kind of relieve that stress they might be feeling. Another thing that we have put together are some calm down cards, which you can use and access on our learning media as well. Shanie, do you mind if I share my screen? I'll show those real quick.
Would you like me to click on it? Is that okay?
Yeah, go ahead. That'd be great. Happy to do that. So these are some example things that they can do. If you have a calm down corner, even if you don't just have a space, you can put these cards somewhere where they can access them, right? So here are some things they can try: some deep breathing, child's pose. They can take a drink of water. You know, if you have a pet fish in your room, or naming your feelings, blowing bubbles, even if you don't have actual bubbles, but reminding them to take a deep breath and blow out like a big bubble, right, will really help. And so these cards, again, are available on learning media if you'd like to access them.
And just because I'm a secondary person, I have to throw in there, a brain break for older kids probably wouldn't be a cool dance, because they would be a little adverse to that. So a brain break for older kids might be like, go, you know, run to the bathroom really quick. And it might be one at a time. Like, that's one of our high school policies, you know, one kid in the bathroom at a time, for obvious reasons. But brain breaks could be as simple as like, okay, shut your Chromebook and we're going to do this instead. You know, we're going to walk one lap around the classroom, or just something that's a little, looks a little different for a bigger kid.
All right. And now we're going to watch a quick video from Sesame Street. I love to show this one to parents as well. It's just really great to see the characters using these breathing techniques. So here's the Count and Cookie Monster sharing their birthday candle breathing.
Greetings, it is I, the Count.
And it is me, the Cookie Monster.
Do you know what I do to calm down when I am feeling angry or upset?
Me guessing it has something to do with counting.
Yes, I count, of course.
Me figured.
Yes, counting can actually help you calm down and feel better.
Really?
It is as simple as count, breathe, relax.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I'm beginning to get a little more explanation of that.
All right, well, it goes like this, Cookie Monster.
Yeah.
First, imagine a birthday cake.
Cake! Where cake?
No.
Someone say cake?
No,
cake.
Cookie Monster,
cake.
No. What? This is what? An imaginary cake.
You mean there's no cake?
No cake, no.
Why you toy with me emotions like that?
I am very sorry, sir, Cookie Monster, but what? My count, breathe, relax method can help you calm down.
Oh, me sure hope so.
Yes, now hold up your fingers.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, like this?
That's right, and pretend that they are candles on the birthday cake.
Cake, me or cake, where cake?
No, it is,
cake.
Again, imaginary cake.
Cake.
Yes. Now, to calm down.
To calm down, yeah,
that's
right.
Yeah. You need to count the candles one by one as you breathe deep and blow them out like this, watch.
Whoa. Oh!
See that?
Oh, okay, yeah, me can now, give that try.
All right, then, we will count. Here okay. we go, let's see your fingers.
Okay, here we go.
One, two, three, four, five. Now, how do you feel?
Hey, me feel terrific. Me calm.
Yes,
me relax.
Yes, you are. Yeah. That is wonderful, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes, and you can try it yourself the next time you're feeling angry or upset. Just remember, count, breathe, relax.
Yeah, it's pretty easy.
Mm-hmm. You could say it is a piece of cake.
Cake, where cake? Me or cake? No. Cake, where? Cake, so. Cake, no. Oh, why you mention cake again?
Sorry about that.
All right, so some things to remember when working with children with trauma. It's hard. It can be hard when they when they're having trouble, right? And it's important to remember that to reframe your view from what's wrong with you to what's happened to you. Your words matter, and so it's really important to kind of think about how you can rephrase things so that they don't sound quite as harsh. When I talk to parents, we do a lot of practicing about taking some of those harder characteristics of their children and turning those into positives, right? So like if they say that their child is very stubborn, then we turn that around. Like, what does that mean? You know, what is a better way of saying that? And they'll say, you know, my child is very persistent, right? And no one's going to ever like bulldoze them over. So just really kind of remembering to keep that frame of mind, and also to remember that these children have suffered trauma and that it's important to stay calm, because without you are the adult in the room and you are the calm and you're your classroom is a place of safety and security and a place where they can come and be themselves. And so it's really important to kind of maintain that. And we cannot calm other people down if we are also feeling out of sorts, right? So if you're feeling anxious or if you're feeling angry or frustrated, then it's going to be much harder to kind of help a child calm down as well. And so these are just some reframing words and views to kind of give a great, I thought this chart was a great example. So I thought I'd share it. But some of the things to remember is, some of the things to remember here, you know, like instead of saying, stop crying, you know, acknowledging like it's okay to feel. I think a lot of people think emotions like anger and sadness are negative feelings, but we don't want to talk in that sense. Like it's okay to feel sad and it's okay to feel angry. It's what we do with those emotions, right? And so helping kids work through that and helping them find healthy coping strategies is really kind of what it's about. And so just kind of remembering also like what the difference between discipline and punishment, right? We don't want to, we don't ever want to punish the children, but teach them, right? How to express those emotions and kind of what expectations are.
Yeah, I think that's phenomenal. And you touched on it, but just to reiterate, like we all feel emotions. It is hard to support kids that are struggling and kids that come from trauma. It's not easy. And so it's okay to feel big emotions yourself and to deal with those. But to remember to be, like Florina said, that rock for that kid rather than joining them in their storm is super important. And it's not easy. So we know that. So this is what we've covered today. So we talked about what does trauma look like in the classroom or kind of in a classroom type environment. What it looks like to build felt safety so that the people that come to us feel safe. They know it's expected. They're going to be greeted. They know what their day is going to look like in general. What tools and strategies we can use when kids don't come to us with all the skills that they need. And then just a couple of things to remember about how to work with kids from trauma in a successful way. So we're going to, before we go to that next slide, we're going to put you in breakout rooms again. And there's no slide to tell you what to do. So you're just going to have to go off my words, which is not ideal, I know, but you can do it. So you're going to go back. You're going to be with those same friends that you were just with. So when you're in there, no need to introduce unless you joined late. We had a couple of people join late. So if you did, you could go ahead and introduce. And then we want you to talk about one thing that you learned that you're going to walk away with. So it doesn't have to be something new that you never had ever heard before, because I'm sure if you went to the previous webinars that you had kind of heard some of this before. But what's something that you can do tomorrow or maybe on Monday? Give it time to sink in over the weekend. But what can you do now from what you've heard today? What's something that it sparked for you? So we're going to put you in those. You're going to have approximately 8 minutes. I think it's about 7, and then it'll kick you back and you'll have a minute to rejoin us. Okay. So you guys were having very lively chats we were seeing. That's great. We're glad we sparked some new ideas or gave you a new idea possibly. So we're going to have people raise their hand if they would like to share maybe something that someone else said in your group, or if you're comfortable sharing something you said in your group that you're planning to take back to your workplace. So your school or your environment that you'd like to share.
Someone said they love the hot chocolate breathing. They're going to give that a try. Megan?
Well, in our group, we had a lot of different ideas. Some of them were liking the reframe, or that just the reframe chart was super helpful to people to think about. And another teacher said that though she greets kids, she doesn't do it as efficiently or as focused as that were in the video. And there's some good examples in that, and she would like to try that.
Awesome. Thank you for sharing, Kate.
Lee Wallace.
Yeah, this one was kind of a takeoff on the different spaces or the flexible seating, but one of our group members had an idea, or actually had experienced having a corner of the room set up as a beach with a beach blanket and an umbrella, and have that available as, you know, sometimes you need to just take a break and go to the beach.
That's a great idea.
I like that too, because that definitely correlates to adult life, right? Who doesn't like to go to the beach to relax? Thank you for sharing, Lee. Cindy, if you're willing, it's kind of brave, will you unmute and tell us about what bag of air for kids means? I have to know.
I think you have to ask the gal in our class, because she said she's had it in her office and kids can go in and just pound on it. But I don't understand, didn't really understand it was like a big balloon thing or what it was, but something like that I think would be good for kids. We've used a pillow. We have a quiet room where the kids can like punch the pillow and stuff. But I like the idea of the bag of air, because they're going to try to get their air out. They're really going to use it to punch, get frustrations out.
Oops, I can share. That was me, I think. I think that was me and this is kind of, I don't know if you can see it there. It's a little deflated right now, but for my kiddos who are experiencing anger, or, you know, I go over with them, you know, it's not okay to hurt people or destroy property, but if you need to get that energy out, you can come in here and just beat that thing up, because it's really durable and really tough. And it gets a lot of use in my office.
It's a wonderful idea. That's great.
Yeah, that's really cool, Sarah.
Someone also mentioned, let's see, Lisa, she said she liked the scheduling concept as well. Yeah, it's super important. And it's really so simple, just to kind of, you know, whether you're just writing that on the board or using pictures for those smaller kids, just really giving them a sense of security by letting them know what's coming up. I just wanted to mention the last couple webinars, I think someone had asked for some reading recommendations. And so I just wanted to give a couple suggestions. There's The Body Keeps the Score, which is a great book. The Deepest Well by Dr. Nadine Burke Harris is great. The Whole Brain Child is another great book. Roger, I'm sure you have a couple recommendations if you want to throw a couple in there. That's all right. Dr. Bruce Perry has also got a lot of great resources. The Boy Who Was Raised as a Dog is a really great book. Oh yeah, the new Oprah Bruce Perry book. It's called What Happened to You, which is exactly what we're talking about, right? Reframing that view of what's wrong with you to what happened to you. And we can definitely share a list afterwards.
Yes, have a list, and I'm having technical difficulties. So for some reason, I'm not able to share my screen anymore, but we will get that list to you guys. No worries as far as that goes. Go ahead.
Oh, the last thing we had was just our emails, but we can put that on the chat. And then we're gonna show a short clip from Resilient Hope Lives Here. And then we'll go into Q&A.
No matter what part of the country you are in, these are tools and strategies and skills that you're learning just to be a healthy human being. You don't have to come from horrible situations. You don't have to have a trauma background to be able to benefit from self-regulation strategies. We see horrific things. We have experienced lots of gang violence. We experience students who are suffering sexual abuse, emotional abuse, and just horrific situations. We've lost students due to gang violence. I could name students who, when they walk in through our doors, they know it's safe here. They know they have adults who care for them and are going to work their hardest to help them be the best little humans that they can grow up to be. What's hard is when they leave our doors. Some students might have cried to you and said, please don't send me home. And they go home and we have no controllables over that little one once they leave our doors. The abuse that kids have, the domestic violence that they witness, we have no control over that. It's not enough for us just to be here every single day. We talk them through horrific situations and then continually teach them that the circumstances that they're currently going through don't have to define who they become and what they choose to do in life, which I think is one of the biggest lessons when it comes to resiliency. It's a hard road. It's not fair. It's not fair that this is the life that some of our kids are coming to us with. If we can get kids starting to believe in themselves at this age, they'll be unstoppable.
All right, it is time now for some Q&A. What a wonderful presentation. We hope you have questions. Oh, see, I told you my dog was home. So that's what happened. She's here, she wants to go out. So if you have some questions, feel free to raise your hand. You can put it in the chat, whatever, however you're comfortable. It's just a great opportunity to be able to talk with Shanie and Florina. So let us know if you have any questions. Gotta love the live part of this. Let's see, any in chat coming up? Looks like we're talking about the books there. And thank you, Florina and Shanie, for sharing your emails. Anyone have any questions?
Go off script really quick and share something I was struggling with. So we were preparing for this presentation over the last month or so, and I was telling my mother yesterday, and she's like, why haven't you told me so long ago that you were doing this? And I said, Mom, because I'm doing a presentation to all these people, and then it makes me sound like I'm perfect and I can do all of this stuff. And I yelled at my daughter today and I had to ask for a redo, and it was horrible. And I said, and I even forgot to say sorry. And she said, you need to say that to them. Like, they need to hear, like, Florina and I have all of these ideas, but we're not perfect. Like, I had to ask my six-year-old for a redo because I yelled at her the other night because she was standing on her leapfrog, which my relationship with her is way more important than a leapfrog. So I think that's important to remember, like, moving forward, that we're all humans, and it's okay. Like, it's okay to make mistakes. It's okay to ask for a redo.
Totally. And we're all living through unprecedented times, still in a pandemic. it's okay to take a, you know, a breather, a break when we need to. I love some of this stuff too, you know, as a parent, even though it's not stuff, you know, I'm not in a classroom setting, but there's just such great skills. I think this is a beautiful way to wrap up our three-part series with some, you know, applicable things that all of us can do and incorporate into our lives, you know, whether just as a parent, in the schools, whatever setting it might be.
Yeah, we talked to parents about the exact same thing, like using those breathing techniques, following a clear schedule, letting kids know what's coming up, especially if it's different from what their normal day-to-day looks like, right? Yeah, there are definitely techniques they can share. And if for some reason that child is in a home that maybe isn't in the best situation, they have some of those techniques to take home with them, right? Those breathing techniques and learning how to name those emotions. And so when I think there was a part in resilience where the lady was like, we have to send them home, right? But you, at least you're sending them with those tools that are so needed.
Yes, for sure, for sure. And she's the principal at a school in Nampa, Endeavor. And yeah, I mean, we did about 48 interviews all across the state and everybody just opened up to us. It was such a blessing. Everybody had important stories to tell. And it's so neat to see how far the documentary is going and how many lives it's changing. Do we have anything in chat? Yeah, the different parents in the backgrounds, that's important.
Yeah.
Well, thank you both so much for your time. I appreciate everything. I think this has been such a wonderful, I feel like a sponge just soaking all of this up. We have a few sponsors we would love to thank: Optum Idaho, the Idaho Children's Trust Fund, and of course, Idaho Public Television. And before we wrap up, we would love your feedback tonight. It would really help us. So we are going to launch a poll. It'll just take you a few seconds to fill it out. It will pop up right on your screen. Oh, looks like the survey is not working. You gotta love the live element of this. Okay, survey's not working. If you have any feedback and thoughts though, feel free, you can put those in chat right now and we can take a look at those. Or of course you can email Shanie or Florina. They shared their emails if you go back a little bit in chat. Also very important, if you haven't seen the full documentary or you wanna watch it again, it is now branded as Resilience, Hope Lives Here. It is available to all PBS stations. So fun to see how far this goes. You can find that by going to idahoptv.org/resilience. And finally, we want to just remind everyone, especially since we are still living in a pandemic, some stressful times, if you or someone you know needs help, we have the 211 helpline here in Idaho. You can call that. So thanks again for everybody's time. Have a great night. Stay safe and take care, everybody.